Hey, this is Nicholas. Let's talk about Pao Zhi, or the methods of preparation. So what does this even mean, Pao Zhi? Well, these are the methods we can use to prepare or process an herb in order to change its properties, enhance its therapeutic effect, or reduce its toxicity or unwanted side effects. So the general term we use for this is Pao Zhi. Pao means to roast, and Zhi also means to roast. Both of these characters have the fire radical, so we can tell that they have something to do with fire or the application of heat. So some examples, we can dry fry or toast the herb, we can stir fry the herb in a liquid, such as honey or vinegar, or we can use other cooking methods like charring or calcining. And again, the reason we do this is to change or enhance an herb's properties before we add it to the formula or decoction. Two other terms we should probably be familiar with are sheng and shu. Sheng just means raw or unprepared, and shu is just a general word for cooked or prepared. For example, sheng di huang is the unprepared version of Romania root, and shu di huang is the prepared form of Romania root. And I should probably point out here that these preparations aren't something that you have to do yourself, and this isn't something you have to make your patients do. This is something that's already done by the manufacturer or the pharmacist. So when you're ordering herbs, you have a choice between regular gansao and jirgansao, or between regular muli and duan muli. So let's go through some examples of the different types of preparations and what effect they have on the body. The first one is chao, or dry frying. This is probably the simplest one. You're taking an herb and dry frying it in an empty wok. And this can do a few things. It can make the herb warmer in temperature, it can increase an herb's aromatic and spleen tonifying properties, or it can just dry out the herb and make it easier to store so it won't get moldy. For example, baijiu tonifies spleen qi. If we dry fry it, it becomes chao baijiu, and its ability to tonify the spleen is enhanced. So why wouldn't we just always do this all the time? Well, let's take a look at another example. Suanzao ren is sour date seed. Suanzao ren is neutral in temperature, and it has two main functions. It tonifies yin and blood to calm shen, especially for insomnia, and it also stops sweating. So if we dry fry suanzao ren, it becomes chao suanzao ren, and that does two things. It makes the herb warmer in temperature, and it enhances its ability to tonify. So if you have a patient with insomnia due to yin deficiency who is also having night sweats, you'll probably want to use regular suanzao ren. But if you have a patient with insomnia due to blood deficiency and isn't sweating, then you might prefer to use chao suanzao ren, since this patient will benefit from the increased warmth and tonification. So Pao Zhi is a way to customize individual herbs in order to better suit your patients. Next we have Zhi. This refers to stir-frying an herb with a medium or a liquid. Some common liquids we might use are ginger juice, honey, vinegar, wine, or a salty brine. So let's go through them one by one. Stir-frying an herb with ginger has the effect of reducing toxicity. For example, fuzi is aconite. It also goes by the name monk's hood or wolf's bane.
As for monk's hood and wolfbane, they are the same plant, which also goes by the name of aconite.
In its raw form, fuzi is extremely toxic. That's why it's called wolfsbane, because people used to use it to poison wolves. But if we prepare fuzi by stir-frying it in ginger, it becomes jirfuzi, and its toxicity is reduced. Another example is bansha, which transforms cold phlegm. Bansha is toxic in its raw form, so we prepare it with ginger, and it becomes jirbansha, and its toxicity is reduced. Another effect of this preparation? Remember that ginger warms the middle jiao and stops vomiting. So one of the functions of bansha is that it calms rebellious stomach qi to stop nausea, vomiting, and morning sickness. So when it's prepared with ginger, its ability to warm the middle jiao and stop vomiting is enhanced. So this is another effect of stir-frying herbs with ginger. It increases the warmth of the herb and relieves nausea and vomiting. And maybe we should point out that, with these two examples, fuzi and bansha, they're so toxic in their raw form that they're pretty much never used unprepared. Because of this, we often drop the jir in the name. So if you just say futsa, everyone will assume you mean jir futsa. Or if you ask for ban sha, everyone will assume you mean jir ban sha. If you want the unprepared form, you would have to specifically say sheng futsa or sheng ban sha. Remember, sheng means raw or unprepared. Another common preparation is stir-frying an herb with honey. Preparing an herb with honey will increase the herb's tonifying and moistening actions. And this should make sense. Honey is sweet in flavor, and the sweet flavor tonifies and moistens. A common example is gansao, or licorice root. Unprepared gansao is neutral in temperature, and one of its actions is to tonify qi. If we stir-fry it in honey, it becomes jir gansao, and now it's warm in temperature, and its ability to tonify is enhanced. Another example is huang qi, astragalus root. Huang qi tonifies qi, but it tends to be very drying in nature. So, it can be stir-fried in honey, and it becomes jir huang qi, and this gives it a moistening action. So the prepared form of huang qi might be more suitable if your patient has a dryness condition, or if you want to take huang qi long-term, and you want to avoid the potential side effect of it being too drying. Next, we have vinegar. Preparing an herb with vinegar can facilitate its entry into the liver channel, and enhance its ability to induce astringency, invigorate blood, and stop pain. And again, this should make sense. Vinegar is sour in flavor, and the sour flavor induces astringency. Also, the sour flavor enters the liver channel. The liver governs free coursing, so it has something to do with invigorating blood. And it turns out invigorating blood is one of our strategies for stopping pain. There's a saying in Chinese medicine, bu tong zi tong, tong zi bu tong. Where there's stagnation, there's pain. Where there's pain, there's stagnation. So by getting rid of the blood stagnation, we get rid of the pain. So you can think of some of these preparations like flavor enhancements. If you remember that vinegar is sour in flavor, then you can remember that preparing an herb with vinegar enhances the actions associated with the sour flavor. For example, we have an herb called yanhu suo, which invigorates qi and blood to stop pain. When we stir-fry it in vinegar, it becomes zu chao yanhu suo, or sometimes just jir yanhu suo. This preparation enhances yanhu suo's ability to invigorate blood and stop pain, and it also causes it to enter the liver channel more directly, making it especially useful for gynecological disorders like painful menses. The next one is similar. We can fry an herb with alcohol. This will also enhance the herb's ability to invigorate qi and blood, expel wind and unblock the channels. Here we're talking about B syndrome, and stop pain. Again, we can think that alcohol goes to the liver, so preparing an herb with alcohol enhances these liver-related functions. Also, alcohol has an upward direction, so this preparation can lift herbs upward and direct their actions to the head and face. You can maybe think that when people drink alcohol, they tend to get red in the face, so this is a sign that alcohol is rising to the head and face. For example, chuanxiang moves qi and blood to stop pain, and it's especially useful for headache. When it's prepared in alcohol, it becomes jiu chao chuanxiang, and its ability to move qi and blood is enhanced, and its ability to stop pain is enhanced. Then the last of the stir-frying methods is stir-frying in salt. Usually the way this works is the herbs are briefly soaked in salt water or brine, and then dry-fried or baked until dry. And so what this does is facilitates the herb's entry into the kidney channel and treats kidney disorders. Remember, the salty flavor enters the kidney channel, so preparing an herb with salt directs that herb to the kidney. So a lot of our herbs that are kidney yang tonics can be prepared this way. For example, buguzhi tonifies kidney yang. When it's prepared with salt, its action of tonifying kidney yang is enhanced. This preparation is called jir buguzhi or yan chao buguzhi. Here, yan chao means salt baked. So those are the methods of stir-frying. And again, a lot of these you can think of as flavor enhancements. Their actions are related to the flavor of the medium we're using to prepare them. Then, besides stir-frying, we have a couple other methods of preparation. One of them is charring an herb. Basically, an herb is dry-fried at a very high heat or baked in a very hot oven until the outside turns black. And this charring process enhances an herb's ability to stop bleeding. What kind of bleeding are we talking about? Well, this could be nosebleed, coughing up blood, vomiting blood, blood in the urine, blood in the stool, or abnormal uterine bleeding, like heavy menses, prolonged menses, or spotting between periods. And actually, we have a lot of herbs that can be prepared this way. For example, dahuang, rhubarb root, is very useful for purging heat from the large intestine. But if this large intestine heat is causing blood in the stool, then we can use the charred version, dahuang tan, to stop this bleeding. Another example, ganjiang, or dried ginger, is very good for warming the interior and expelling cold. The charred version, called Pao Jiang or Ganjiang Tan, is good for stopping bleeding due to coldness, especially uterine bleeding due to cold from deficiency. So charring an herb stops bleeding. The next one is called Duan or calcining, and this process is usually applied to shells or minerals. So in Chinese herbology, not everything is an herb. We also use shells and minerals like oyster shell, abalone shell, gypsum, and hematite. So to calcine an herb or substance, you basically put it in an oven until it becomes red hot. So one effect of this is it makes the substance brittle and easier to crush. So for example, shergao is gypsum, and it's very good at clearing heat. Sometimes we want to use it topically to clear heat from the skin, but it's kind of hard to apply big chunks of rock to your skin. So what we do is we calcine it, and it becomes duan shergao. And now, it's very easy to crush into a fine powder, and we can mix it with oil to make a salve or a paste to apply to the skin. And this is also called shu shergao. Remember, shu just means prepared. But another effect this can have is it can enhance an herb's ability to induce astringency. For example, mu li is oyster shell. Since it's a heavy substance, it's very good for anchoring yang and calming the shen. But it also has an action of inducing astringency to stop sweating. If we want to emphasize the second function, then we can calcine mu li and it becomes duan mu li, and its ability to induce astringency and stop sweating is enhanced. And the last one we'll talk about is kind of a weird one. It's called wei, or roasting in ashes. I can only think of two or three herbs that are prepared this way, but one of them we learn is rodoko, which is nutmeg. The way it goes is like this. Rodoko, in its unprepared form, has some oils in it that can very easily upset the stomach and cause diarrhea. So what you can do is make a dough or a paste out of white flour and then coat the seed in that paste. Then you bake the flour-covered seeds until the outside turns black, and this process draws out those irritating oils into the paste, so you can peel off the shell and discard it, and now the nutmeg is safe to use. This is called wei rodoko. Again, I can only think of a couple examples where this process is used, like rodoko and hezi. A similar process is used with ba do, which is a very toxic herb. And here, they actually use absorbent paper to draw out the oils, and that's called ba do shuang, or defatted ba do. So these are some of the common methods of preparation, or pao zhi, that we'll encounter in herbs class. And there are, of course, a lot of other methods that we didn't mention here. For example, herbs can be dry-fried with rice or bran or even earth, usually to enhance its earth-tonifying effect. Herbs can be steamed and then dried, sometimes repeatedly, several times. That's how ginseng becomes red ginseng. To reduce an herb's toxicity, we can also use licorice instead of ginger. So when we talked about jirban cha, one way to reduce its toxicity is to prepare it with ginger juice, and that's called jiangban cha. Jiang means ginger. But we can also prepare it by soaking it in a decoction of licorice root and lime, and this is called faban cha. So jiangban cha, since it's prepared with ginger, is better for rebellious qi, like nausea, vomiting, and morning sickness. Faban cha, since it's been prepared with licorice, is better for cases involving spleen qi deficiency. There's even one form of preparation that involves using cow bile. We have an herb called tian nan xing, and it's warm in temperature, and it's good for treating cold phlegm. But if we prepare it with cow bile, then it becomes dan nan xing, and its temperature changes from warm to cold, so now it's good for treating phlegm heat. This is the only example I can think of where we can change the temperature of an herb from warm to cold. And then, we should probably point out that there are some herbs that can be prepared multiple ways depending on which action we want to emphasize. For example, remember when we talked about yanhu suo, the painkiller? This can actually be prepared in a couple different ways. Preparing yanhu suo with vinegar will direct it to the liver channel, making it especially useful for painful menses. Preparing yanhu suo with rice wine will make it rise to the head, treating pain in the head. Preparing yanhu suo with salt will direct the actions downward to the kidney and lower jaw, making it useful for hernia pain. So that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Chinese herbology, be sure to subscribe and check out some of the other videos on this channel. But I hope you enjoyed this one, because that's all for today. Thanks, and see you next time.